Ee, bu ne?
Tema sere bu ana.
Niye?
Bu ana sere mu?
Uko ndani bwana.
Leo uko faster.
Acha tu bwana. Uko tu nimekuita.
Hayo kujaweka vijana.
Hapana he, usiweze ongea hivi vijana wanatungojea hapo nje.
Sonare aje mzee yuko?
Ako bwana.
Hayupo tuko si wawili bwana, hebu kwanza tuache hiyo story.
Tuko wawili, wacha niingize vijana, ni ku make host. Sijui ni wewe utaingiza ama ni kuingizie.
Waingize alafu wakifika ni ku admit, tunaweza wa admit.
Wacha ni admit hapa 24 alafu ni ku make host, uta admit wengine ukiendelea.
Alafu ulipewa nini?
Nini yo?
Allowance.
Ile barua nilipata.
Ya hii kazi.
Ndio unaona niko na sai kiwiki bwana. Mimi sitaki mchezo. Wewe hujapata?
Hapana, imagine mimi hata ndio nafanya ile utoto mimi.
Lazima upate bwana. Kwani si ni wewe ndio una recording?
Si ndio nashangaa.
Hebu kwanza ni admitia tutaongea na simu kumaliza lesson.
Sawa.
Hai.
Hello everyone. Good afternoon. It's yet another week, and as we wait for the others to join, I can see currently we are at around 41 participants. It's my hope and my expectation that all of us are taking care of ourselves back at home. And I'm saying this because, of course, we've had a number of things. You know what is happening across the country. There are series of, there's already a virus that came our way. But then, of course, finally, we must ensure that all of us participate or do our part, regardless of the challenges that we are going through. Now, last time, and I hope everybody has a pen today because there are quite a number of things that we are going to put down in writing so that we work as a team throughout the lesson. Now, I intend to start the lesson right away. And of course, I should be through around at least 3:30 they test. The reason that is advising us on what we are doing today or what we shall be doing next is the fact that, you know, this is was informed by some of the areas that are under challenge that you wrote to us. And then we decided these are the areas we are supposed to revise going forward. Now, last week I was with you trying to undertake a number of areas that needed to be addressed. And among them was the issue of trade. And we started then by talking about, the challenges, the introductory part of trade, a brief history of how trade began. We went to further to define what is trade. And then from definition, we looked at the types of trade. Those are the things that you really need to remember very well. And it is out of that then that you also looked at, other than the types of trade, the methods that are used in trade. And on the type of trade, then we started with the first one, which is the local trade. We looked at the origin of this trade, the extent to which then this trade is conducted. And more so, we also talked about the geographical extent and again also the organization characteristics, impact of this trade to the communities that were involved in. And there were quite a number, and we tried just to highlight them for purposes of understanding for all of us. So I think from that we moved forward. And we talked about another type of trade we refer to as the regional trade. And with the regional trade, I was able to state, that the trade involved, a larger geographical area, as opposed then to the, the local trade. Now, besides that, we said that there are this type of trade, we have two very common, or there are only two major examples of this regional trade. I talked about the long distance Akamba trade that was covered in Form 1. And besides also, we talked about the long distance trade, we also talked about the Trans-Saharan trade. We said this is a trade that took place across the Saharan desert. It's a trade that took place across the Saharan desert. And as such, then this trade involved, of course, people who participated in this trade. We said we had people from the northern region. And these were the people known as the Berbers. Then we had the Arabs participating in this trade. And besides that, we also said then in the western part of Africa, then we had in the western part of Africa, we are the people of Western Sudan. And we said this group of people occupied a very huge area we refer to as the Sudan Belt, crisscrossing all the way from where today we have Liberia, or the western part, the extreme western part of Africa, and coming all the way to where today we have the modern day Khartoum or Sudan, Darfur, and such areas there. So We took talk that I emphasized on the path of the organization of trade and how you can easily get the points and how you're supposed to elaborate and elucidate those points when it comes to answering them in the examination, because just a revision. And I think it's out of that, then that we besides looked at the factors for this trade, the challenges the people went through, and finally, we talked about the results of this trade. And that was where we left, and I told you what it was important, and I hope you did categorize them, dichotomize them into either social, political, economic, and otherwise. So today's session, we start first by a it did not happen because of some challenges here and there, and therefore I had to take over. And I hope you bear with that. Then, of course, I will continue with the transatlantic trade. And it's also good to prepare you, because before we close for the holidays, then after this topic, I'll go to the next topic, not unless now it is advised otherwise in the walls. Another area that you really said was a
Mark Davis, mute everyone.
Auntie Alibi.
Hi.
Namazeni.
Mohamed Farah and the rest, those who have joined recently, there is a lot of noise making. There is a lot of noise making. Mohamed Farah and your colleagues there. That exhibit some sense of restrain when it comes to how we carry ourselves. Eh? Thank you very much for that. So we continue, and like I was saying, and I want to prepare you in advance. Once we deal with this area, we are not going to revisit the area again. And we are talking about an area the constitution and the constitution making. I'm saying next week, then we shall indulge or we shall engage on
constitution
and the constitution making. And it's an area that requires a lot of attention. So I hope people will be prepared for a revision of that area all the possible questions we can experience or from the sim, then will be dealt with categorically when we touch on that next week. I might take you through, or alternatively, then we shall interchange with Madam Ouma in Form 4, then she will take over Form 3, I go back to Form 4. Otherwise, nonetheless, we have to start what we intended to do today as we wait for the others to join. And among the issues that we said we want to do today is an area, in fact, that formed the reasons why most of you are saying that they have a challenge in this area, and this is the transatlantic trade. The reason is because we finished on something we refer to as we finished on the trans-Saharan trade. And like I've said, we exhaustively talked about the areas of interest and what is expected of you in the examination. Now, of interest today then is the international trade, because we said the types of trades are categorized into three, starting with the least in terms of geographical area, we referred to as the local trade, followed by another trade we refer to as the regional trade, with a case study or a case example of the trans-Saharan trade there. So today we embark now on the third type of trade we refer to as the transatlantic trade. This is an international trade, and this trade, of course, we're going to see that it's a type of trade that has a very rich history when it comes to how the world history is as it is today, even in the 21st century. I know you've heard about the Black Lives Matters, and the Black Lives Matter is an issue. Is an issue that is very is an issue of with a lot of interest. Then we can agree that this is if you look at the history behind it, is because of how the Africans were treated. Immediately, the United States of America attained independence. Where were these Africans in the USA coming from? These are Africans who came from a slave trade. They were participants in the transatlantic slave trade. And of course, after independence, then the president, who was the first president of USA, was a gentleman by the name George Washington. And he decided what was supposed to happen is that most of these Africans then were to be repatriated back to the continent. And that is why they established free slave areas and countries like Liberia. So majority of them were taken back to Africa, which was good, and they are the people now who live today in what we refer to as Liberia. But the majority, vast of them, remained in America. And it is from those historical injustices, the perception that the Africans then were still not civilized enough. They were still uncultured, according to them. They never enjoyed the privileges we refer to as the white privileges. And they have gone through thick and thin over the years then to suffer as a result of that. Now, I'm not here today to talk about slave trade and such things, or the history of USA. That's another thing for another time. But then I want to show you the historical aspect associated with that as we try to understand the transatlantic trade. Now, of essence is, whenever we talk about the transatlantic trade, by nature and by characteristic features, is just like any other trade that we've talked before, which and its own unique characteristics. Now, the very unique characteristics associated with the transatlantic trade, also known as the triangular trade, is that this form of trade took place at a time where the geographical locations and the technological innovations allowed for the movement
Yo. I'm checking my wang.
Hey, somebody there. I'm saying that I hope now you can get me. If I'm muted, you can text me so that I see what is happening. So I was saying that the transatlantic trade. I was saying that the transatlantic trade, of course, involved people of different continents. It involved people of different continents there. And the continents that were involved in this trade were three. They are majorly known as three, but we also know that it involved people of Central America, South America to some extent, but the majority of the participants then came from the Northern America continent. And the continent involved are very common in the exam. That's why I wanted you to note them, that the continent in we had the American continent, and also we had the European continent participating in that trade. So what happens is this trade, now that we've the three continents, then we have to realize that the three continent as we know them, prior to this trade, when you look at the periodization or the period in history at this time, they had their own historical facts on the ground. Like in Africa, we know that before the transatlantic trade, of course, there was a flourishing trade we refer to as the Trans-Saharan trade. There was quite of an influence of Islamic culture, religion, Islamic influences in the continent. While we know at the same time when this trade is happening, this is when then Europe is rising. This is the time when the nation states are being formed in the in the continent Europe. It is at this time that we know that Europe was going through a period of radical changes in agriculture, and therefore we know it was going through both agrarian revolution and industrial revolution. And we know at the same time, the American, as we is known in the past, then is one continent, of course, that are very few people, and it is nearly the same time that it is discovered. So the discovery of the America by people like Akina Christopher Columbus, of course, opened up. And that's why we refer to it as a new world, a new set of opportunities then for the people of Western Europe to participate in this trade at that time. And that's why I want us to be very much aware that very little was happening in America before this transatlantic trade and before the discovery of the Americans then by the people we refer to as explorers like Akina Christopher Columbus. But of essence in this trade is the fact that we need to know that it doesn't isolate Northern America from the rest of the world. Of course, there are people who are indigenous, people who are living there, and these are the people we refer to as the Red Indians. So they are spread in different other parts of North America. And when we shall look at this trade, you're going to see majority of the people or the countries that bore the influence of this trade were not only the America itself, but spread even to places like Canada. It went even further deep where slave trade was also very common in countries today like Barbados, we and countries like Haiti, we have Jamaica, all those countries within then the area we refer to as the Caribbean islands. So we have quite a number of them. So I'm saying, when you look at this prior to the transatlantic trade, of course there was an influence, or there is a very rich history behind them. And you're going to see, like the coming up of the industrial or the radical changes that took place in manufacturing, the rise of factory system in Britain, and in the entire of Europe later, when Germany joined in the 1850s there, you realize that, and also a lot of influence again also on this trade. So both the Industrial Revolution, the Agrarian Revolution, and an influence on this triangular trade. So of essence, I've said, is that we have to note that the continents involved in this trade were three among them. Then we had the Africans, and we're going to see, just like with the Trans-Saharan trade, the commodities involved differed from one area to another. So when you look at this trade, the transatlantic trade, then of course, having involved the three continents of a form of a trade, or a type of a trade, that commodities crisscrossed from one continent to the other, and so on and so forth. And what guided how the trade was conducted takes us back to what we talked about last time, when we said that the trade involved, or for the trade to be successful in terms of how it's practiced, then there must be application of the laws of supply and demand. So there were those commodities that were in very high demand from the African continent, and also in high demand from commodities in high demand in America, and commodities that were also in high demand in Europe. And those are the ones then probably we shall be how that one took place there. Now this trade, in terms of the origin of this trade, the trade began in the 16th century. The trade began in the 16th century. And the majority of the participants, of course, who began this trade, were people who were either in the trade before or took advantage of the decline of the Trans-Saharan trade. Remember we said the Trans-Saharan trade declined because of the emergence of a competitive trade we refer to as the transatlantic trade. The attack by the Ottoman Turks at this time from the current day-to-day country we refer to as Turkey. All these challenges then posed a threat to the existential aspect of the Trans-Saharan trade. And again, considering that these explorers were moving across the world, when they settled in Africa, and particularly in West Africa, that is where now they started taking the role and interacting with some of the participants of the Trans-Saharan trade, and particularly the middlemen there, and they started creating a rapport, a form of a friendship that built the genesis of this trade at around the 16th century. Now, it is also at the same time when we say that this trade began in terms of origin, that in the same time that the America was discovered in the 15th century and part of the 14th, 15th century there by people like Christopher Columbus, and the influence in the 16th century peaked because of the Industrial Revolution, 16th, 17th century, where there was an influx in population, and therefore there was need to settle the surplus population in other parts of the world. And the easiest place to settle them now came with the discovery of the New World. And therefore, the Western European people went and settled in America, settled in a very vast region. But however, we know that Industrial Revolution came with an ideology we refer to as capitalism. And one of the factors of production in capitalism is labor. Therefore, when these people settled in those areas, there were no huge population to provide the necessary labor to the farmers in order to facilitate the agrarian revolution. So what do they opt for? These people had to opt for something we refer to as the use of slave labor. And that is why you likely to realize that the participant, required the labor, and the only source of labor that was cheap so that they can the concept of capitalism based on the ideas or the ideals that it's all about profit making. So for the profit margin to increase for these settlers in the new world, then it meant that it was necessary them to invest in slave trade in Africa. That's why you come now to realize that the demand for slaves in Africa played a very significant role in enhancing the development of the transatlantic trade as we know it today. Other than that, then also in those areas where they settled, they practiced large-scale farming. And we know that from the concept of the agrarian revolution, large-scale farming came with the economies of scale. And the economies of scales associated with this practice, therefore meant that there are things that they produced and of course needed to be supplied elsewhere. And these commodities in that chain of the triangular trade are the ones that found their way in Europe. So I want us to talk about the same. And we also realize that even in Europe, there are commodities that produced which were either in high demand in America or were in high demand in Africa, therefore completing the cycle of the triangular trade. So I want us now that we move away now from the origin, we look at the commodities that were involved in the transatlantic trade, very common in the exam. Now it's very confusing, because sometimes you realize that, and the examiners are shifting away from that, everybody knows that the main commodity from Africa was the slaves during the transatlantic trade, which is not questionable, which is true. But some would want to know whether you know the other commodities that were also very key and very important during the transatlantic trade, emanating or they were in huge supply from the African continent, and where were they destined to? So I want us to note these commodities from the African continent other than the main commodity. What if somebody in section B want to know, is the student aware that it's not only the slaves that were involved in as part and parcel of the trade, in the transatlantic trade? So note the following were also commodities that were exported from Africa. Note somewhere with on your notebook there. And the main commodity was slaves. Very common in section A. Many times, if you look at the past KCSE in the Global Links and other books, you'll always find that slave was the main commodity. But ask yourself, what if an examiner asks you, other than slaves, name two commodities that were exported from Africa during the transatlantic trade to the Americas. And by Americas, now I talk about North America, the Caribbean islands, and those other places. So write the export from Africa to other export other than slaves from Africa to the Caribbean or to the Americas here. And these commodities were the following. We had cocoa, rubber. We had rubber, and also we had kola nuts. Mark those two, because in any exam, those are the things we'll keep asking. We know that you know, and the students of your caliber, when they know, we only need to twist to know that whether you know those are the extra ones. So we have I've talked about cocoa, rubber, and also we have coconut nuts. And even today, they are major export actually from West African countries like Ghana which and Cote d'Ivoire, which are major exporters of cocoa to the world. Now from there, then at the same time, we had commodities then that were exported from Africa to Europe. And mark you, and I want to say this one to underscore the fact that it's a very important point. There were no slaves that were taken to Europe. No, in one time in the history of Europe that you're going to find that there were slaves that were taken to go and work in Europe. In Europe, they never made use of slaves. For one reason being, by the time slave trade was becoming popularized, Europe had attained some significant level developmental milestone in terms of industrialization. So the machines there were the ones then that would have played the role that was played by the workers. And at the initial stage of the cottage industries then, there was no trade like the like the slave trade or the transatlantic trade. And mark you, actually these people at the initial stage of this trade, they had an advantage because at the initial stage of industrialization, where they had the cottage industries, then for them, they were able to take comfortably the industrial journey because the agrarian revolution and divided the people and stratified them to either owners of land as a major factor of production in the rural areas, and those who did not have the land, because of the Enclosure Act that we talked about in Form 1, then were pushed to go and work to live in the cities there. So that landlessness brought about by the enclosure system is one that provided a significant pool of labor that was used in during the industrial revolution, and therefore there was no need. And I repeat, because students will always forget about this in the examination, we never had slaves in Europe. There was no demand for slaves in Europe. So what were the commodities that were in key demand in Europe at this time from Africa? If I decide to ask, Madam Uma can ask you, Madam Guru can ask you, what were these commodities from Africa? Although sometimes it seems like it's very rare, these are the unique things probably you as a student need to understand. Number one is gold was a very key commodity in Europe. However, the gold that was there at the time of the transatlantic trade was in very small commodities or in very small pockets. By small pockets, I mean, much of it had been exhausted during the trans-Saharan trade. That's why we said the main reason for the decline of the trans-Saharan trade was the exhaustion of the main commodity from Western Sudan, and this commodity was gold. But the retro remnant and pockets of gold mines here and there is what now the European capitalized on and exported from Africa and took the same to Europe. That's one commodity. Commodity number two was ivory. Ivory was very important in the industries, then to make different other things, faces, ornaments, and so on and so forth. Like we know even today that ivory in itself is a very highly regarded commodity. And that's why we have the wildlife departments where they protect the animals from poaching. So what happens, those two main commodities were very key from Africa. Then now we go to to the Americas. What were the commodities from America? What were the commodities then from America? The main commodities from America, very common again also in the examination, and this one I know you know, but put also them down for purposes of revision. We had cotton, we add another commodity, we refer to as
sugar, and we had another commodity there we also refer to as tobacco. So we had tobacco, we had sugar, we had tobacco, we had sugar, then we had cotton. It's also one of the commodities that was very commonly used during the transatlantic trade there. Other than that, then there were also commodities, of course, that were exported now from Europe to Africa. They were in high demand in Africa. These commodities included the following, also very common again in section A. They included the following. Number one, we had what we refer to as clothes, gunpowder. Gunpowder was also a very common one. Then we had another one we refer to as the guns themselves. So we had the gunpowder, and clothes. They are summed together also as finished products. Remember, at this time, the only area where we could get this finished product, which was a result of something we refer to as manufacturing. Manufacturing, where was it coming from? We said the cottage industries. Cottage industries, where were they? What did they give birth to? The cottage industries led to rise of the factory system in Britain between 1750 and 1850, and also leading to spread of the scientific knowledge to other European countries, resorting to industrialization next of a country we refer to as Germany. Remember when we were talking about the rise of Germany under Otto von Bismarck? The confederation and bringing together of different German to form a confederate state of Germany, which by 1870 then undertained also industrialization and surpassing even Britain. And particularly we see it when we talk about the Franco-Prussian War of 1870-71, where the acquisition of the provinces from France of Alsace and Lorraine then gave an impetus to this country to become even more industrially progressive. And it remained from that time to be a force to reckon even in the 20th century there. So now we move away from the origin and the commodities. Then we ask ourselves briefly, because we need to ask ourselves this question, what were the factors then that promoted this transatlantic trade? What were the factors that promoted the transatlantic trade? And that is my point of interest today. One, you likely to realize that the transatlantic trade would not have happened if the following factors or reasons did not play a significant role. One, you realize that we had what we call the fact that we had trade links. Trade links between the European and the Africans played a very significant role there, and not Africans, but the people of West Africa. The trade links between is a factor that you need to note, that those trade links between the European and the people of West Africa. Where is this trade link coming from? Then at the back of your mind, you're supposed to realize that this trade is coming at a time after the decline of the trans-Saharan trade. And it's also coming at a time in the 16th century and also in the 15th century, when in the world history, periodization tells us that this time in history was a period of exploration all over the world. Even kings, even world leaders at that time invested in exploration, like in Portugal. So this is a point that we also need to note that played a very significant and a very pivotal role
in enhancing the transatlantic trade. So trade links, these trade links were enhanced by the exploration nature of European people in the 15th and in the 16th century. And these links then strengthened the trade. So it started from simple links. In fact, even we're going to see when we talk about it in the topics in Form 3, to a point they even intermarried, leading to emergence of new breed of people in West Africa, known as the Mratus. That's how the link close it was. And you know, with those connections then, it means that it played a very significant role in enhancing that trade. Number two, there was also availability of markets. Availability of markets. Now, we know that in trade, and those who take business studies will tell you that trade will not exist when there is no ready supply and ready market for commodities, demand and supply. So the ready market was very key, because for these three, for the triangle to be complete, it means that there was need for trade to have demand at every point. Maybe in North America, demand must be there of a commodity. For example, a commodity like slaves. Then there must be demand and supply for a commodity in a country like, in a continent like Africa, in West Africa. The finished commodities you have talked about, sweets, clothes, you know, rams and so on and so forth. The kings, you know, fancied those very foreign commodities then that were coming at that time. So the chiefs now developed a sense of taste for those European commodities and goods, which of course made the trade also to flourish there, because there was demand for commodities from Europe. There was also demand for supply, enough supply for slaves from Africa to other parts. So that network then is one that we are saying created markets. So it's a factor that is very key in that. The other point is the emergence on the use of firearms. Remember, as the world evolved in terms of political domination, then then also inventions that came in terms of military prowess in different countries. So around the 15th, 16th century there, then now it comes the use of firearms. Shifting from classical, traditional methods like the Maasai, the way they use the mikukis and whatever, and arrows there, then now to use of more modernized weapons. And the Africans were also excited by existence of these weapons. They were also excited by existence of these weapons. Why are we saying they were excited by existence of these weapons? It's because then these weapons were the ones that were used in slave raiding. And mark you, we've said slaves were a very key product, then a very key important aspect that formed the backbone of the transatlantic trade. Then we go to point number four, the plantations. The existence of plantations and mines in America. Where are these plantations coming from? We would never have the transatlantic trade in America if we did not have first the Industrial Revolution, first actually the Agrarian Revolution in Britain, which then forced created surplus production, surplus population, and therefore there was needed to supply the excess to America. So those who went there, they established what we refer to as plantation farming. And this plantation farming then is the one that I'm saying played a very key pivotal role in enhancing, played a very key important and pivotal role in enhancing trade or the existence of the transatlantic trade, because there was need of something I said at the beginning, that, you know, this concept, the whole concept of industrialization and trade was a concept that was not there before the 12th century and such. And even if it was there, then trade was purely for consumption. It was not for profit making. But the concept of profit making that creates now the group of village we see today is something that was created by the rise of industrial and agrarian evolution, which brought about a new ideology of capitalism. And I said one of the factors of capitalism, if we can name them, some of the major factors of capitalism, if we have to mention them, then we have factors like, number one, we have a factor like land. Land is a very key important factor of production. That's why these people wanted to go and rush to occupy as huge plantations as possible in America. Labor is also another important factor of production. In the 20th century and 21st century, we talk about entrepreneurship as a factor of production. So in this case, labor was a very key important factor of production to enhance something we refer to as the existence of a transatlantic trade. Otherwise, without a necessity of labor, which in this case must be cheap labor, because for capitalism, unlike communism, which tends to create a classless society and equalizes everybody, for capitalism, it creates classes of people. And one way of creating classes of people is to ensure that then you maximize on profit. How do you maximize on the profit? Maximizing on the profit must be found within the factors we've talked about. If it is capital that you are investing, then you must ensure that you invest more capital, and in that capital you plow back a lot of profit. You cannot profit that by paying people a lot of money. So they had to look for cheap labor. And when they realized that the Africans were uncultured as they perceived them and uncivilized as they perceived them, then it means that it was necessary and important for them then to invest in slave trade to maximize on profit. And I hope that's a point that you must always see and ask yourself, why the hell did we have to have a slave trade in the first place? Why didn't they not pay people? Even today in Kenya, if the owners of capital, those who invest in businesses and so on and so forth, if they fail to maximize on labor, then they will make very little capital, very little profit. Because the motive behind capitalism is to make profit anyway at the end of the day. And that's why we are saying it is very key, very important that we must invest in that. So the plantation and mines, we go back now to point number four, increased the demand for slaves. That's where I was trying now to elaborate. Plantations were in America, meaning there was availability of land as a factor of production. Then we also said that the labor that was required then, they needed where they would pay as little as possible to maximize on profit. That is why, to enhance the ideas of capitalism, these people had to ensure that they engaged in slave trade, which was free. In fact, they were spoiled for choices because they had to look for the best of the slaves there. Now we move away from that. I hope it's understood. Then the role played by the Industrial Revolution in Britain. Why are we talking about the rise of industrial revolution in Britain? Is because the industrial revolution played a very important role in ensuring that there was an increase. There was existence of commodities. It involved what we refer to as industrial
which was very important to facilitate the industrial revolution. Where do they get these raw materials? Of course, we're not getting majority of the raw materials from Africa. These raw materials were obtained from the Americas. But for these raw materials to be obtained, there was for labor. So that's where we see it as a major factor, there. Now we move away from that because of time. Availability of trading participants who are willing to participate in the trade. Merchants, traders, people wanting to invest in this trade, they were there and very willing to participate in investment. Why were they interested in participating in investment in this trade? They were willing to participate in the and invest in this trade. One, because, and we go back again to Europe, we said that in Europe they had what we refer to as already developed the system of industrial and agrarian revolution. So the owners of capitals there, they were amassing a lot of wealth. So they were looking for areas to invest that wealth. And that is why we are saying these are the people who invested their money then in industrial revolution, who invested their money from the industrial revolution then in this trade, so as then to create and amass more wealth, leading to something in the 20th century we refer to as the rise of financial imperialism. So it's also a point there. Number five, just like in the Trans-Saharan trade we said cannot exist without a means of transport. So another very important factor in the transatlantic trade was an existence of an elaborate, an elaborate system of transport. Whereas the other one took place overland. So the main system there involved use of caravans or camels across the Saharan desert. This other one then made use of what we refer to as a significant and well-developed water transport across the Atlantic Ocean. That's why we call it the transatlantic trade. That's why, if not a transatlantic trade, we call it the triangular trade. But one way to access the three continents mentioned then was through the use of the waters. So that's a very key aspect about that. So please note, and I will read them through again, the factors for the development of transatlantic trade are the following. Existence of well-established trade links. We've said number two, the existence of markets for commodities. We've said number three, the existence of firearms. When you are told to justify, don't write. And we always tell you, don't write one word answer in history. So it is fire. Did they go to hell or did they go to heaven? Were they used to fight COVID? So you must tell us, what was it that made use of firearms? And these firearms, then they enhanced acquisition of slaves during the slave raiding process. Then number four, we have said existence of plantation and mines in America. These plantations were the ones then that needed the workers to go work there in the States. About the Industrial Revolution, availability of trading merchants or availability of traders who invested in the trade, and also finally, the existence of a great transport system known as the use of cargo ships or the use of water transport during the transatlantic trade. Okay, move away from that. Hello, so you relax a bit, you move away from that as you note those points. We go now to the organization of the trade. Organization of the trade. Sasa hii nayo is also another hot one. Just like the organization of trade during the Trans-Saharan trade, aka kaswari vijana wakikaona, they now start, you know, sweating and wondering, why is this question coming? And it is 12 marks. I want to tell you this. In history, we don't have 12 points where you have to give 12 points for you to get 12 marks. Every point is always multiplied times 2. Whether you're told to discuss, whether you're told to elaborate, or whether you are told then to describe, whether you are told then to illustrate, what you need to know is that the point, just like for the organization of the Trans-Saharan trade, they have a formula. First of all, you need to ask yourself, as a serious student of history, you need to ask yourself, how was this trade organized? In the Trans-Saharan trade, we say it was organized between two, there must be places, physical places where it is organized, between North Africa and Western Sudan in the south. So that point by itself gives you 2 points. So how are you supposed to answer that one in the examination? Because physical point where trade takes place will always give you point. Those are free 2 points for Trans-Saharan and also for the transatlantic trade. You don't need to cram, you need to understand them. And we have said this is by virtue of the definition that we've said that it is triangular. So we have 2 points, that 3 points that form more of a triangle in the system of this trade. So by that point, and I want you to write there for 12 marks, describe the organization of transatlantic trade. Describe the organization of transatlantic trade. Write that point there. Naona huku wale watu wanaingia na magari eh?
Kabisa.
Tulia anko, tulia. Okay, umeandika hiyo swali. Organization of the Transatlantic Trade.
Tulia pango.
There will be a serious challenge. It's going to be a serious challenge. Why am I saying this? Is because the reason I'm saying this is because these points are very simple. Point number one, as good is the physical distance, and we're going to relate this with what we did before. So I'm saying the physical presence. Somebody is talking. Kaidri, give us some sense of. Thank you. So we are saying that this trade was organized. So the first point we write here: where was it organized? Was it organized in Mars? Was it in Jupiter? Or did we have some Africans who are in the Jupiter setting there? Those movies, eh? We want to ask ourselves where. That's what a bright student asks yourself. So the point here for 2 marks is the trade was organized between America, Europe, and the African continent. 2 marks. Alafu na kanyanga kubwa kubwa, sindio? So the trade was organized along the 3 continents, America, Europe, and Africa. Therefore, it was known as the triangular trade.
Yes.
So, you cannot compare yourself like somebody who is in Karabatura. You are in a national school. You get to that point and you move on. You go and revise something else. Point number two, you ask yourself, who are the major participants now from Europe? Major participants from Europe. Remember we said also in North Africa, we had major participants from North Africa. They were not ghosts. They were not only camels. There were people who were involved there. Who are they? We talked about the Berbers and the Arabs. Now in this trade from Europe, the participants actually are also common in the section A were the following. We had the following participants from Europe. In terms of nation states, foreign major participants from Europe. We had Portugal, we had Spain, we had Holland, we had a country by the name England, and we had a country by the name France.
Please repeat.
Point number three. When you give the main commodities, you get a point. For example, we say for the whoever is
asking.
Please repeat the major participants.
Major participants. I'll say the major participant of the major European powers were the following: Portugal, Spain, Holland, England, and France. Those were the major participants.
Thank you.
Welcome. So we continue. We have also said now, like we said with the, you know, I'm trying to relate the two so that you see the closeness of the points on and the organization. That's a pattern. It's not something you cram. That we said with the trans-Saharan trade, that the trade itself involved major commodities. These major commodities must be mentioned in that organization. That now gives us the sixth point. So we write this. The main commodities from now for the three pockets or physical places, Africa, America, and Europe. So we are saying the main commodities from Africa was rice. Unandrai nako. Main commodities from Africa were rice. Iyo tumesema slaves, then unaita comma. While the main commodities, now we are in America, the main commodities from America were sugar. We had sugar, tobacco, and cotton. So you know, it's a very serious issue here. Whoever is prayer, you know, I'll get you. And we are here on a very serious thing.
Yes.
We are talking the main commodities then from Africa were slaves, from America, from Africa was slaves, from America were sugar, cotton. You can name one of them: sugar, cotton, and tobacco. While from Europe were finished commodities. So I thought I talked about that at the introduction. Apo unapata the six mark. Zaburi tu. Which one of the other one? We go to the third one. Now we go to the slaves. Slaves are so many points that you can get now to get other points there. How are the slaves obtained from Africa? So you can put it this way in the exam. The slaves were obtained from the interior of West Africa. The slaves were transported from the interior of West Africa and taken to the coast.
Pardon.
I'm saying slaves were obtained from the interior of West Africa and transported to the coast. Now allow me to explain this point. Now the organization means now we are now in Africa where the main commodity was trade. But Mark, you remember we said the other commodities, but the main commodities was slaves. Now, how are these slaves obtained? The slaves were obtained from the interior of West Africa, sometimes even went even down once to the south. So what happened is that the transportation of these slaves then from the interior, The process began with the capturing and obtaining of slaves. After obtaining the slaves, then the slaves would be transported. Once transported, they would be stored. I use the right, because they were commodities, they would be stored then in various docked areas where they would stay in readiness for transportation. So what happens is that that process of transportation to the coast, then they would be arranged in order of whether they are very, in terms of use. What I mean is, those slaves that were very productive, because they would be gauged on productivity based on age, based on sex, based on masculinity and such. So they would look for those slaves that were highly productive, and they would then organize them in grades, the best to the least who are not very productive. So what we are trying to look at in this point is that you must always know that there are places where these slaves were kept. And in most instances, these places then developed into major ports. And these major ports are very common in the examination. That's why I want you to note this also as a point that you can use to justify and get another additional, is it 8 marks or around now 10 marks? So let's write this. Some major ports developed where the slaves were sold, and they are very common in section A also. And they included the following. At least you must know two or three. They included the following. They included the following. We had Lagos, depending on where you come from. Lagos, Elmina, E-L-M-I-N-A. Then we had Commander. Then we had Accra. Then we had Badagazi, B-A-D-A-Z-I. Those were the major ports. Kaidri, underline them there. And know that they are common in section A. But if I were you, because they are only 2 marks, we don't have a mark beyond 2 marks in section A, and only mark Accra and Lagos. The slaves from the interior were obtained through the following ways. This point number 10. You don't mention all of them. You can mention one of them or two when you are writing about organization. The slaves were obtained through the following ways. They were exchanged. Slaves were exchanged with European goods. For example, they could have exchanged Yaya Ture for some, some sweets, a packet of sweet, if Yaya Ture was born that time. So that's how they did it. Then number two, they could also have obtained the slaves through wars. So prisoners of war were sold as slaves. So you start a war, you fight, if you lose, you and your people, you are sold as slaves. And this is something that resulted to depopulation anyway in Africa, and a lot of enmity, mistrust among the people. Then also, some Africans, of course, were kidnapped and sold, like lonely travelers. If you are lone travelers, those who are traveling alone in the village there, on those parts there, those are the people who would be sold as slaves. Some children were enticed with sweets. Of course, they would also read for children at the age of around 7-8 years. By the time they get to America, they are 10 or 11. They are mature people. So those are some of the things they would do. They also got the slaves through raiding the villages. Finally, the debtors were sold. Debtors were sold as slaves. So if you owe me some money, you don't pay me on time. Of course, what happens is I will sell you the next morning if you are somebody who is in the age of productivity. Both the productive and the reproductive age. So that was the point there. Other than that, then we ask ourselves, once now at the port, the slaves, then another point.
Sure. And panyaring.
Panyaring is the same as raiding for those slaves. Panyaring. It's only I don't want to use the word panyaring. You know, it looks like panya. It's the same as slave raiding. So we don't like using that. Sometimes, but you can still have it there. We read that once at the port, the slaves were docked into the ship, or they were sold into they were tightly packed into the ship, where some would die on the way. Once they die, what would happen? They were thrown in the what? In the Atlantic Ocean. So we Africans, we've gone through thick and thin. Eh? So they were, they went through some serious problems. Some of them, of course, would be thrown into the Atlantic Ocean. Now, finally, once in America, the slaves were auctioned. Auctioneering. Ile unapigua kengere. Now, the auctioning was a very unique one because the traders were organized into different categories depending on productivity. Now, these slaves were not only from Africa. During the time of auction, the slaves were not only auctioned in Africa. The auctioning was slaves from all over the world. So in an exam, somebody would want to ask you, why were the African slaves preferred other than other slaves in the world? One, the African slaves were believed to be immune to diseases. These are people coming from the tropic, the tropical and equatorial regions. So they were seen to be immune to diseases. Number two, The African slaves then were very, very, very strong. So they were immune to diseases, were very strong, could last longer. Because, you know, these are commodities. They are not people. You're not going there to go there as a slave queen. No, you are there because you are strong and you can work. So what happened is that at that time, the Africans then were deemed to be the best compared to those from South America, those from Asia, China.
Okay.
The Africans would be seen to be good. Thirdly, the color of the Africans. The Africans, they were strong and masculine, yes, true, Tumeunga. Then number three, the Africans then were, the color of the Africans was highly favored by the European. Our color, we could be spotted. You know, they are white people, we are black people. They could easily spot Africans. So when you have your slave who is black and the other people are white, they could easily spot the African. So the color of the Africans was a preference before they went to the Chinese and to those other workers there. So those are some of the points I wanted you to note. And I wish then that you stick to know those points on organization. They are simple and they should not actually be a major challenge to us. Now, because of time, I want to go then to the next point. Na haka diyo tukireta kwa mtiani, watu wanaokota mbili, mtu wanaokota moja, then you start walking around the staff room asking for marks and for different teachers. And this is what I want to talk about. And this is the final time. Hopefully that I'm going to talk about it because the must stick in you. That does not mean by the time you're in Form 4, we shall still remind you of the same again. That is the reason for the collapse of the transatlantic trade. Yes, it flourished for a very long time. And I have a lot of stories to tell. It's only that we don't have time. But then I would want to look at the reasons that led to the collapse of transatlantic trade. In the examination, different examiners will refer to them as factors for the decline of transatlantic trade. There's a time I remember I set this question in the exam. It was said, then I marked. People complained. In fact, there's an entire class where they were saying, but teacher, this one is supposed to be right. It cannot be right if it is not given as a point, which is an answer, or that qualifies to be an answer, followed by a very elaborate justification. And that is what I want to talk about, because I know you know. The reasons for the decline of transatlantic trade. These reasons then are also sometimes, even as we continue to remind me, that the reasons for the development of transatlantic trade, sorry, for the decline of transatlantic trade are also sometimes twisted in the exam as reasons why Britain, reason why Britain championed the fight against slave trade. The two questions are similar. There are some points which are the same, but they are also dissimilar in a way. They tend to diverge at a point. Why? Because Britain is not the entire of the whole process that led to decline of trade, but it is part of Europe. Europe was part of what led to decline, or what happened in the 18th century in Europe, and a role to play in the decline of transatlantic trade. However, the answers are multifaceted. The answers are not in line from one continent only, but they are answers then that revolve around a wide range of activities that happened in 18th century going forward that led to decline of the transatlantic trade. Now I want to be very swift, because I really want to take at least 7 minutes to be through with this. I will elaborate and explain, but then I'll be very swift. Assume now it is in the examination. It is section B, part B of that question. It is 12 marks. You are told to give the reasons for the decline of the transatlantic trade. Why would you get the point and why would you not get the point? Yet you think the point is true. Now, depending on the examiner in the internal exams, we tend to be very strict, but finally might get the point. But we say that you have to give us an answer and a reason that justifies or qualifies that answer that you're giving. Not just writing something and leave it hanging and expect to get a point. These are the points. One of the reasons is the rise of industrialization. So I underscore rise of industrialization. Of course, it must be industrialization in Europe. The rise of industrialization in Europe, which led to the industrialization, of course, when you get industrialized, you don't have, you know, those machines where you start now listening to music at homes. We are talking about business where people invest in machines. We are talking about complex systems. We refer to them in Form 2 as the rise of factory systems in Europe, and particularly beginning in Britain and spreading to other Western European nations before then industrialization becoming a global phenomenon. So what we are saying is that there was the rise of industrialization is the answer, but cannot give you the 2 marks. You must tell us what industrialization did. So it is the rise of industrialization, and what it did must be in line, must be in tandem, must be in must tell us then that what you're saying must have a connection with ending of slave trade in the 18th century. So you must tell us the rise of industrialization in Europe, where there was the use of machines, is a justification. Lakini bado wakajafika, use of machines, lazima ufike pale mwisho. Use of machines which replaced human labor. So there was no need for invention of machines. Sorry, for use of labor, because the machines replaced the human beings. I don't know whether that point has been understood. Rise of industrialization in Europe, where there was invention of machines which replaced human labor. Or you can tell us which were more effective than human beings. They were more effective in the sense that they were more faster. You know, producing, milking a cow using your hands is not the same as milking the cow using a machine. They are not the same. So those are very self-explanatory points. Point number two, the attainment of independence of USA. You say that it is attainment of independence, but we know it is the declaration of independence. But anyway, they attained independence nearly the same time. So the attainment of independence of USA in the year 1776. And if you know that you are not smart in remembering the years, don't mention the year. Just leave it like that. So it is the attainment of independence of USA. We know USA attained independence in 1776. So the answer there is attainment of independence. How did they trade now to decline in transatlantic trade? That's the point I want to get from you guys. So the attainment of independence in 1776, when USA declared itself independence from Britain and went ahead then and started to form a constitution, we refer to as the Philadelphia Constitution, and in the year 1786, then USA under the first president as George Washington, and the underwritten constitution, one of the most liberal constitution in the world, known as the Philadelphia Constitution, which had its own features that even us Kenyans borrowed from them centuries later, and we are using them then to try and see whether we can apply the same democracy in our country.
Yeah.
So the point is America's attainment of independence. Now that is the answer. The justification must be, which rendered stroke made Britain lose its colony, therefore no need for slaves in America. So that point is very clear, that what is it, the attainment of independence leads then to the loss of a colony from Britain. Britain was the one that was obtaining slaves in Africa to go and work there. Where do they go so that there is that hegemony of power? So that they don't feel humiliated, then they have to come to Africa to colonize. Because once they were through with America, they came now to Africa to colonize us. And that is why we are saying the attainment of independence of USA by Britain then forced Britain to come to Africa. And for them to take control of Africa, they needed the Africans to work in their continent. So they decided then to bring to an end slave trade from their point of view. So that is a point. So they needed labor back in Africa. So I think that's a point also we really need to understand. Then the other point is the rise of economists. The rise of economists is the answer. You can give an example such as the rise of economists, such as, you can write the rise of economists, people like Adams, who argued that free men were more productive than slaves. It is easier to work with somebody who has the freedom of conscience than somebody with a forced mindset to do something. So it's self-explanatory. Always remember that. Free people are more. William argued that free people, Adam Smith argued, sorry, that people, free people are more productive than the other. Then we go to the other point. Missionaries, the role played by missionaries. Christian evangelicals, these people, I put them as one. Missionaries in the 18th century and the rise of the Christian evangelical movement in the 18th century, where now we start seeing Christian missionaries moving from Europe, coming to spread the world all over the world, and even coming to Africa, having people like Akinaru doing craft, there is a role they played in stopping slave trade. Why? These people are reading the Bible, and particularly in the New Testament, where the Bible categorically stated that somebody forcing another person to work in itself is evil. Because the dualism in the Bible is either something is good or something is what? Wrong. Is either something is right or something is evil. So to them, slave trade was evil. And any examiner will not mark anything else. You must tell us that the rise of Christian missionaries who argued that slave trade was evil. So they were against slave trade. And as they preached across Africa, they preached a doctrine against slave trade. And in it, they were advocating for establishment of legitimate trade there. Then the other one is the rise of the role played by philanthropists. Now, philanthropists are different from Christian. You can be a philanthropist and not a Christian. You might have a soft feeling for other people to help them. And again, you are not a Christian. You are not atheist. You remember there's that guy who is an atheist and was trying to help a certain student join the high school by paying school fees for that young man. So these are philanthropists. They want to help, but they don't lean on religious beliefs. They have no inclination to any religion. So there was argument of such people in the 18th century. And in Britain, we had quite a number of them. One of them was somebody known as Wilberforce. We had somebody like Wilberforce who argued, now for the philanthropist, argued that slave trade in itself is inhuman. And what were Omzuri? You know, it is inhuman. They are not saying that it is evil, they are saying it is inhuman. So we must always have it in our mind when you're making an argument that it must border on those key aspect argument made by either an economist, either a philanthropist, either a Christian evangelical believer or a missionary, all those then are points that were there. Then the other point was the role played by the French Revolution of 1789. The role played by the French Revolution of 1789. Which stated, you know, the French Revolution or the Napoleonic Wars then were fought because of some values the French people felt were denied to them by the conservative monarchy before, where you remember we say that there's that wife, then to the king, who told the people that when they were in crisis, if you cannot have bread, then why can't you have cakes? And what happened is that the people stormed the Bastille then to demand then for what was rightfully theirs. And that is time that the king fled. And you know, that now created a revolution. And when the king fled, there was a vacuum in leadership. That is how Napoleon Bonaparte in 1788, who was just a soldier, actually was a private soldier to be very precise, and he took over. Why did he take over? It's because in that vacuum then, the people needed somebody to lead them. And it ended a revolution that lasted from March of 1789. Then, I remember very well, up to the year 1815. And that is when Napoleon was brought down, when he tried then to attack or to conquer the entire of Russia. That time he had conquered the whole of Europe, and was only remaining in Russia, but invaded in the wrong time when it was in winter, and he lost seriously. And after that, then there was a convention of the Congress of Vienna to try and sort out the mess that was created then by Napoleon Bonaparte. But all in all, the Napoleonic Wars, the French Revolution, gave birth to the ideologies or the ideas of liberty, the ideas of freedom for all, the ideas of equality of all people, and therefore, those were the ideas where they argued that everybody in the world was free. Regardless of whether you are black or whether you are white, everybody has that inherent, that natural right within himself to live. And that is how then the proponents of the French Revolution, the proponent of the ideals of the French Revolution, spread it all over the world that we needed then a world free where people would not be treated as slaves. So liberty for mankind, equality for mankind is what was treated there. All that in a nutshell means that in the examination, you tell us about the French Revolution of 1789 as the answer which advocated for equality and liberty of all mankind, hence fighting slave trade there. Then we and also the contribution of Africans themselves. We had some kings somewhere in Congo who are writing to various others in Europe and administrations there, like Akinans, Nzinga Bemba of Congo, who argued that they were telling them that they were not willing to sell their own people and that these countries must not go looking for slaves in his kingdom there. Then also, we under the role played by slave revolts in some countries or some areas like St. Domingos, where these slaves then killed their master. And you know, once you kill your master, you own everything. So they killed their master and they took over that role. So finally, we and also the role that was played by the American Civil War, this war of 1861. And 1865. Now, it is not, because this is another challenge in the examination. The American Civil War, and now that you're at home, these are some of the things you really need to be Googling to see whether you can get the point right. The American Civil War was not a civil war. Something civil or a civil war is a war or a conflict within a government, within a sovereign state. So it was not like you state in the examination that it is civil war between North America and South America. Those are two different continents. But it was a civil war between one continent, North America, today USA, the peoples in the North and the peoples in the South. And you realize that those in the North were against slave trade, while those in the South were for slave trade. Now, when these people fought in 1861, when the war began, then you realize that those in the North won against those in the South. So if the majority wins, then it means that the war against slave trade was won. It is as simple as that. But don't tell me that it is those in the North and those in the South there. So those are the points that I felt were very clear. However, we've seen in the examination, many of you have no problem with the effects of the transatlantic trade. The only challenge is, and which I will now deal with in terms of points, is that you have to tell us the point then that are supposed to be written, the points that are supposed to be written and in what form are those that affect the Africans, a number of them. Do they affect those that affect the the Western European. So we want to see the negative to the Africans, the negative to the Western European point. But I will try to look at them and then share with you there. But I thought that idea of the organization of the trade, the collapse of the trade, the why the African slaves were preferred, then the commodities other than slaves and the manufactured goods that we've talked about are very key points that you really needed to have for you to revise. Gentlemen, I think you'll allow me to stop at that point so that you can also prepare for something else. But I will make a summary of all this by giving you all the possible questions and answers for your own revisions. We shall share with your teachers so that you have them to revise and to have a look at what we have discussed at length. Nonetheless, then it is important as you prepare next time to know that we shall engage in a more common area in the examination. In paper one, that is the constitution and the constitution making process. It's an area that is a challenge, but now that we have all the BBI and the change of constitution, I think that will be the best time for us to discuss the policy and the constitutional framework, the guidelines that we have, the achievement, the milestones that we've made as a country to reach where we are today. So that will be our next engagement. But before then, trust you me, I'll have to give you all the possible questions. Those with the handouts we gave you on the questions, you'll see them. But it's good also to make sure that we generate them ourselves and we share with you people in readiness for the exam as you prepare, because we've always said that it's Mangu and others. So we must take it with a lot of seriousness and respect the fact that then what we are going through is for a short while, of course, greater things are coming our way. I trust and I hope that we continue washing our hands, we continue doing the right thing, listening to our parents, engaging in positive use of whatever that we have at home, the internet, the books, and any material, so that then we can mold ourselves to be greater men. So I'll stop from there, and then may I say that I wish you a nice week ahead as we continue. And we thank you, and most sincerely from my point of view, for the kind of maturity that I've seen you guys exhibit since we started this process. I know it's not very easy, but it takes a lot of resilience, it takes a lot of self-discipline, it takes a lot of respect, and even self-respect for all of us then to be where we are today. I wish to stop from there, and thank you very much for your time.